Please join me in the responsive reading this morning, number 646 in your gray hymnal, The Larger Circle. And clasp the hands of those that go before us. We enter the little circle of each other's arms. And the larger circle of all creatures. To a music so subtle and vast that no ear hears it.
Let us enter a brief time of meditation and contemplation. I invite you, if you're comfortable doing so, to close your eyes and take a breath and to let your body relax. Let yourself fully arrive in this moment and in this place. Breathe again and let your thoughts drift. Let them be as broad and spacious as our summer sky. As you begin to move into the stillness, feel your heart begin to soften and open, expanding until it can contain all the sorrows and joys that are part of being fully human. Breathe. And as you let your attention spiral inwards to that still place at the core of your being, feel yourself being held in the warm embrace of this community. Breathe. Breathe. Take a moment just to be. Amen, and blessed be.
We have two readings this morning. The first one is Somebody's Baby by Barbara Kingsolver from her book of essays, High Tide in Tucson. As I walked out of the street entrance to my newly rented apartment, a guy in high maroon high tops and a skateboard haircut approached, making kissing noises and saying, "Hi, gorgeous." 3 weeks earlier, I would have assessed the degree of malice and made ready to run or tell him to bug off, depending. But I didn't either. Instead, I smiled, and so did my four-year-old daughter, because after dozens of encounters, I understood that he didn't mean me, but her. Well, for most of the year my daughter was four, we lived in Spain, in the warm southern province of the Canary Islands. I struggled with dinner at midnight and the subjunctive tense. But my only genuine culture shock reverberated from this earthquake of a fact. People there like kids. They don't just say so, they do. Widows in black, button-down CEOs, purple sneaker teenagers, the butcher, the baker, all would stop to have little chats with my daughter. Routinely, taxi drivers leaned out the window to shout, "Hola, guapa." My daughter, who must have felt my condition flinch, would look up at me and wide-eyed and explain patiently, "I like it that people think I'm pretty." With a mother's keen myopia, I would tell you absolutely my daughter is beautiful enough to stop traffic. But in the city of Santa Cruz, so was every other person under the height of 1 meter. not just those who conceded to be seen and not heard. Whenever Camille grew cranky in a restaurant, and really, what do you expect at midnight? The waiters flirted and brought her little presents, and nearby diners looked on with that sweet, wistful gleam of the eye that I thought diners only reserved for the dessert tray. What I discovered in Spain was a culture that held children to be its meringues and eclairs. My own culture, it seemed to me in retrospect, tended to regard children as a sort of toxic waste product. A necessary evil, maybe, but if it's not our own, we don't want to see it, hear it, or God help us, smell it. The second reading is Overwhelmed, Work, Love, and Play When No One Has the Time by Bridget Schulte. This is the day I have been avoiding for more than a year. Today I am meeting with John Robinson, a sociologist who for more than half a century has studied the way people spend their most precious, non-renewable resource, time. Robinson told me that his research proves that I, a hair-on-fire woman struggling to work a demanding full-time job as a reporter for the Washington Post, and be the kind of mother who brings the turkey for the preschool feast and puts together the fifth grade slideshow and have 30 hours of leisure time in a typical week. Today, he is to dissect the mess of my time diaries and show me where all that leisure time is. I feel as if I'm a bug pinned on a specimen tray about to be flayed and found wanting. Because this is how it feels to live my life, scattered, fragmented, and exhausting, I'm always doing more than one thing at a time. And I feel I never do anyone particularly well. I'm always behind, I'm always late, with one more thing, and one more thing, and one more thing to do before rushing out the door. Entire hours evaporate while I'm doing stuff that, well, needs to get done. But once I'm done, I can't tell you what it was I did or why it seemed so important. I feel like the Red Queen of Through the Looking Glass on speed, running as fast as I can, usually on the fumes of 4 or 5 hours of sleep, and getting nowhere. And since I had kids, I don't think I've ever had a typical day.
So a quick survey. How many are actively parenting children or grandchildren right now? Okay. And how many here have either grown children or no children? And here we're not counting your four-legged fur children. So grown children or no children. And how many have grandkids that someone else is raising? Okay. And how many can still remember and are willing to admit that you yourself were once a kid? Okay. So this sermon is actually for all of us in any of those categories. Last Sunday, I talked a little bit about scarcity and about the way that human beings respond to scarcity in predictable ways by narrowing our focus to addressing the immediate challenge before us and ignoring everything else that might be outside the scarcity tunnel. Many of us, particularly in that window where we're also parenting, live or have lived for long stretches in that time scarcity tunnel. And I think there are two reasons for this. I think perhaps we live in a state of time scarcity because we have exceedingly high expectations for what life is supposed to be like. But I also think we end up in the scarcity tunnel because increasingly our culture tells us that we're supposed to be parenting, by ourselves. Now, most of us really want to be successful at whatever we do for a living, and we really want our primary relationships to be rich and happy, and we expect to create safe, comfortable, even beautiful homes. We feel entitled to rich and varied and cultured, altruistic, civic-minded leisure time. We strive to have meaningful spiritual lives and to make the world a better place. We are determined to raise wonderful, healthy, creative, and successful kids, and we are going to do all of this well and within the existing 24-hour day. Yeah, right. Let's get real. It cannot all happen at the same time. If you are someone who does not have children or whose children are grown, if you are someone who is independently wealthy or retired, well, then you might have time to cultivate a spiritual life or pursue a rich and meaningful leisure. But for those of us who are working and parenting full-time and following our present cultural norms about how we're supposed to do that well, it's really hard to find any time left over to do anything else. If our culture offered reasonable expectations for work and provided adequate support for families, then it's actually possible for people to work and parent and create lovely homes and volunteer and have hobbies and spiritual practices all in that same window. But our culture has really stringent expectations of workers and a growing distaste for children. And that places us, those of us who are parenting, between that proverbial rock and the hard place. Rather than seeing children as one of the best parts of life, the cream puffs and meringues and eclairs, as Kingsolver describes them, rather than understanding children as productive members of their families, households, and economies in their own right, rather than acknowledging the full personhood and inherent worth of every child, our American culture increasingly treats children as the sole responsibility of their parents, a liability at worst, and an expensive hobby at best, one that interferes sometime with the adult's ability to earn and spend at their full capacity, one that should not, under any circumstances, be allowed to intrude upon the lives and resources of adults not their own. This same culture is happy to market things to children and to exploit them to make money, but it's astonishingly unwilling to participate in the well-being of those same kids. Ironically, our society isn't even willing to grant the parents of the next generation the kinds of supports that would make parenting easier and allow parents to be productive, engaged workers. Things like paid parental leave, quality childcare, a solid education, affordable universal health care. Now, this seems really counterintuitive if you're thinking about the next generation as sort of the replacements in the economy, but if you're thinking about children as someone's personal choice and hobby, well, we don't typically subsidize people's hobbies, do we? Given that this is a widely spread attitude in the culture we live in, it's no wonder that parents feel overwhelmed and people who care about people who are parenting feel overwhelmed. And life sometimes feels more chaotic than beautiful. But the chaos isn't actually new. The Buddha recognized the problem 2 millennia ago, with the insight that human life is dukkha, dukkha is a hard word to translate. Usually we think of dukkha as suffering, but a particular kind of suffering that is caused by a human attachment to a particular set of expectations, or a need to control what's going to happen, how it's going to happen, and what the outcome will be. I think that's a pretty good diagnosis of what afflicts those of us who are actively parenting right now. We are attached, those of us who parent and those who do not. We are attached to a whole set of outcomes, and when they don't work, we suffer. We believe that we should be able to write it in the day timer, to plan the sequence of things. And when those careful plans go awry, we're confused and disoriented. The truth is that when we live with other human beings, especially human beings at a different life stage than our own, humans who are older or younger than we are, it's just not possible to control for everything. According to an article on the recent parenting book, All Joy, No Fun, the older we are when we begin parenting, the more difficulty we actually have with the natural chaos of being a family, presumably because we adapted to a different kind of lifestyle in that space between being a child and having a child. In the interval between the time when we were children and the time we have children, we can conveniently forget that children are not anyone's hobby. They're not personal projects. They're not property. They're not problems that we're supposed to solve. They are fully human beings. They are mysteries to be witnessed and nurtured and cherished and respected. And they are not just their parents' responsibility. They are the responsibility of the entire community, because the community reaps the benefits of human beings who are loved into wholeness. For those of us in the midst of parenting, and for those of us who love people who are in the midst of parenting, there are some ways to make it easier. There are some ways to cope with the overwhelm and to get more comfortable with life in the middle of the whirlwind. These are strategies that take to heart the Buddha's teachings about attachment and control as the source of much of our suffering. I have 5 suggestions this morning. Stop believing in the fairy tales. Refuse to be perfect. Give back the housework. Trust the inherent worth and dignity of your partner and your kids. And share your family with the rest of the world. So let's take them one at a time. Perhaps the most important thing that we can do to learn to love the chaos of our lives with or without children is to change our expectations about the kind of life we think we deserve. We all have mental pictures about how we would like our lives to be, how they should be. There's actually an entire industry of websites and magazines and TV shows and movies all devoted to setting up expectations that they know we cannot meet. They're devoted to showing us how our homes and our meals and our bodies and our relationships and our gardens and our children and our weekends could be if only we had sufficient staff, the capacity to outsource or edit all the day-to-day maintenance, and the option of photoshopping the good moments to make the light even better. Now, I don't have any objection to lifestyle or parenting or cooking or gardening or health or exercise or sports or travel websites or magazines or blogs. They're a wonderful distraction when you're brain dead at the end of a long week. But don't get attached. Remember that while small slices of what they offer might actually be relevant in your life, you're best off treating all of it as pure fiction. Lived-in houses are never picture perfect. Real families are not harmonious all of the time. Grandchildren are sometimes rambunctious. The neighbor kids will play their music too loud, and parents and old people get grumpy on a regular basis. Do not let yourself be tempted into thinking that the happy illusions the media paint are real. They are trying to sell you something. Do not buy it. Instead, if you have to have a vision of how it should be, create your own. Choose an aesthetic that's clean enough to be healthy and neat enough so you can find stuff, but messy enough and grubby enough that you and the people you love can actually be happy. Choose an aesthetic where the people are more important than the stuff. So my first suggestion for learning to love the chaos of life is that you stop comparing your life and your family and your choices to anyone else's. If you work at it for a while, you might even be able to stop comparing the life that you have to the one that you imagined that you would have. Now, the easiest way I know to do this is to get a journal and to begin writing down all of the people and activities and events in your life that bring you joy. All of the things that happen that you value, describe all the relationships for which you are grateful. Use your journal, whether it's paper or electronic, to help you pay attention to the details of the life you are actually living, and then live that life. If you are in the midst of the life of a working single parent, live that life. If you are newly partnered, be newly partnered. If you are longtime married or recently retired or newly widowed or a brand new parent, or if you're coping with a difficult diagnosis, don't sleepwalk through it. Pay attention, even when it's hard. Don't miss your life while you're waiting for somebody else's happily ever after. So, along with letting go of our attachments to some imagined picture-perfect life, it's also really helpful to let go of being perfect yourself. Whether your attachment is to being the perfect employee, or the perfect volunteer, or the perfect spouse, or the perfect parent, it's not possible. And so we set ourselves up. Instead, aim to be a good enough employee, or a good enough parent, or a good enough partner. Show up and be clear about what it is that's your part of the work and about how much you can actually get done in the time allotted. And then do that work and enjoy it as much as you possibly can. And then stop and go home and eat and rest and be with your friends and your family and live your life, not just your job. Your work and your relationships and your family, everything's going to be better for it. Attachment to having the perfect house and the perfect kids, attachment to being the perfect spouse or parent or employee, sets up impossible expectations and paves the way for disappointment. Once we let go of those attachments, everything gets easier, especially step three, letting go of the housework and the laundry. You see, a third part of learning to love the chaos that is life, particularly the chaos that is life with kids, is to give back some of those tasks you took on when they were little, to give back some of the tasks that make your life particularly chaotic. So give back cleaning the kids' rooms and making their lunches and supervising all their homework. Give back entertaining them every minute of every day and let them entertain themselves. Allow every person in your household to do their fair share of the day-to-day maintenance of their lives. Now, my favorite parenting book at present is written by an author named Vicki Hoffel, and it's titled Duct Tape Parenting. Now, before your fantasies get away, run away with you, actually, the duct tape is for the grown-ups. According to Vicki, there are two reasons to give back that day-to-day maintenance, to give back the chores, and to reduce the chaos by doing that. First of all, how many of you find sorting laundry and scrubbing toilets intrinsically rewarding? Me neither. One of the things that Hoffel notes is that parents who feel like their children's servants tend to carry a pretty heavy load of resentment and frustration, and that makes them emotionally unavailable to their children. Now, when you think about it, which is more important to the well-being of any of us, but particularly of our children? An emotionally available parent or partner, or a maid or chauffeur? And if that doesn't persuade you, this might. Every time an adult does for a kid something that that child could do or should learn to do for themselves, the adult deprives the child of an opportunity to become more competent and more confident, okay? I know it's easier to make the lunch yourself than it is to clean up the dehydrated jam on the counter tomorrow, but really. This brings us to the fourth premise in learning to love the chaos of life. Trust your spouse and your children. There was a great article in The Atlantic magazine a couple of weeks ago titled, The Overprotected Kid. It was talking about how the level of risk-taking and the freedom to roam which were granted to children have sharply declined in the last 30 or 40 years. Grown-ups who roamed free and in the woods and who traveled across the city on the bus or their bikes when they were children have been persuaded that the world has become much more dangerous and that their children now need to be protected and supervised at all times. But the studies don't bear out the increased danger. Years of safer playgrounds have not actually reduced the number of accidents, only made playgrounds boring. Years of constant adult supervision have deprived kids of the opportunity to step up to challenges and learn their limits. Sheltered kids, it turns out, kids who are supervised 24/7, turn out to be much more fearful and less creative than children who are sometimes allowed to explore and who are encouraged to take risks. There is a parental attachment here, an adult attachment to these ideas of safety and control, and they turn out not to be good for the children. So the next part of learning to love the chaos is to allow for more chaos by letting go of needing to have control and by trusting the kids to take their own risks and solve their own problems. If you put it on a timeline, 18 years isn't very long to go from being totally dependent at birth to being ready to be launched in the adult world. Coping with the small stuff, like making lunch or getting to school on time on your bike or the bus, is relatively low-risk practice for being in charge of yourself later on. So, let go of the perfect life, let go of being the perfect anything, let go of the housework, let go of being in charge of your kids' lives, let go of trying to keep them perfectly safe. There's a lot to let go of to learn to live happily in the chaos. Fortunately, we're not letting go into the ether. We're letting them go into something which can be good. This brings us to idea 5. Now, how many of you, when you were kids, could ride your bike anywhere in the city? And how many of you knew that your parent was going to know exactly what you did all afternoon, because every neighbor who saw you, every person who knew you, was going to call your mom and report in? Oh, I saw Gail on her bicycle on the far side of town. Or how nice that she took the little girls to the swimming pool. Or you did know that Gail's boyfriend pulled his car into the garage when you were gone. I actually had a lot of freedom to come and go, partly because there was this vast but informal safety net that was created by the adults all over my city who knew me. And they knew me because, like all the other kids in my town, I was semi-public property. My family were active in the community, and my parents consciously shared me and my sibs with the neighbors. We babysat and shoveled snow and raked leaves and took in people's mail and mowed their lawns. In that time and place, letting go of your kids didn't mean casting them to the four winds or leaving them at the mercy of the ravening wolves. It meant sharing them with a larger but still connected community. Now, we could still do that here. Santa Fe is not that large a place. And I do see all of you around town and all of our kids from time to time. If you think about it, the kids that we see hanging out at the plaza or roaming around will grow up to be the adults who will deliver your mail, report the news, clean your teeth, do the surgery on your shoulder, run the city and the state and the nation. They're the ones who are going to need the tools to solve global warming. And it's up to us to help them get the tools that they need, even if we're not confident that we will be around to see or benefit from the results. In fact, we should probably support the kids around us right now, because by supporting the kids, by being part of that expanded safety net, we take some of the pressure and overwhelm off of their parents. And their parents right now are the adults who repair your car, manage your apartment, help with your taxes, manage your investments, and provide your health care. Wouldn't you like them to have a few neurons free to focus on those things? So the fifth suggestion for learning to love the chaos of family by letting go of attachment is to share the wealth. Build community. talk to strangers, chat with kids and with shopkeepers, walk the dog and greet your neighbors. Learn to talk across the generations, whether it's here at the potluck or standing in line at a grocery store. It is safer for parents to let go and share the parenting, and safer for kids to take risks if there is a wide, known network of supportive adults who are standing out there ready to catch. So, throw out the Norman Rockwell paintings and let yourself and your family be imperfect. Let go of being employee or volunteer or parent of the year. Share the chores and reinvest your energy into being emotionally present. Trust the kids and let them take risks and become competent. And finally, introduce your kids to the community and members of the community to your kids and help them take care of each other. Privatizing children, privatizing childhood was a lousy idea. It made everybody unhappy, and there's a better way, better for the kids, better for the parents, and better for the community. Kingsolver ends her essay, Somebody's Baby, with the following anecdote. My second afternoon in Spain, she writes, standing in a crowded bus as we ricocheted around the corner and my daughter reached starfish-wise for stability. A man in a black beret stood up and gently helped her into his seat. In his weightless bearing, I caught sight of the decades-old child treasured by manifold mothers in his neighborhood, growing up the way leavened dough rises surely to the kindness of bread. As Kingsolver reminds us, we need to be careful what we give to the children. Sooner or later, it's exactly what we will get back. May it be so. We are not asked to look at the light of our chalice. We are asked to look at, love, and heal the world which its light illumines. Would you join hands, please? Okay. May love and skill be in our hands. May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love flow through us and walk among us this day and every day. May love flow through us and walk among us this day and every day, as we live our lives and help to heal our world.
As we live our lives and help to heal our world.
Amen, shalom, blessed be, namaste, oho. Please turn and greet your neighbors. All right, just a...